بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We welcome to start a new session from film reading lecture. And as usual, we start with a neuro case. This is a 6-year-old boy who came for MRI CSF spirometry with no available history. This is the axial T2 and axial flare images. We can see there is a moderate dilatation of the ventricular system, supratentorial ventricular system. This dilatation is out of proportion to the extra axial CSF spaces. This means that this is a hydrocephalic changes, not atrophic changes. So once you determine that this dilatation is with a hydrocephalic changes, you should determine the level of the dilatation of the ventricular system to differentiate between obstructive or communicating type of hydrocephalus. So we must look for the third ventricle, if the third ventricle dilated or not. If the third ventricle is not dilated, so this is mean that there is a proximal obstruction and this is an obstructive hydrocephalus, and usually the level of obstruction will be at the foramen of Monroe. If there is no dilatation, if there is a dilatation of the third ventricle, if the third ventricle is dilated, this means there is no obstruction proximally, and we should look for the fourth ventricle. Okay, in this case, the third ventricle is mildly dilated. As we see in these axial images, we can see the dilatation of the third ventricle better at coronal images. As here, there is a ballooning of the third ventricle, so the third ventricle is dilated, and this means there is no obstruction, no proximal obstruction, and no obstruction at the level of the foramen of Monroe. So the next step is to look for the fourth ventricle to determine if the fourth ventricle is dilated or not. If the fourth ventricle is not dilated, this means there is a proximal obstruction, and the proximal the obstruction will be at the level of the foramen of Monroe. If the fourth ventricle is dilated, this means that the hydrocephalic changes is due to communicating type of the hydrocephalus, and there is no obstruction. So in this case, we can see that there is a mild or minimal dilatation of the fourth ventricle. We can appreciate the dilatation of the fourth ventricle here in the sagittal images. Sagittal T2 images. This is the 10th section. Sagittal T2 images, we can see that there is a dilatation of the fourth ventricle here, and mild dilatation or minimal dilatation of the fourth ventricle, and this with the communicating, this means that there is no obstruction, and this with a communicating hydrocephalus, there is no level of obstruction along the foramen of Monroe or along the aqueduct of Sylvius, which are the most common site for obstruction. Okay. Also, we can see an important sign here is exaggeration of the signal void along the aqueduct. This exaggeration of the signal void along the aqueduct of Sylvius means there is a hyperdynamic circulation along the aqueduct of Sylvius, and this again confirms the diagnosis of communicating type of hydrocephalus. The communicating hydrocephalus is associated with exaggeration of the signal void and hyperdynamic circulation along the aqueduct of Sylvius, and again this confirms the diagnosis of communicating type. If you are not sure about if the fourth ventricle is dilated or not, you can depend upon the sign of the exaggeration of the signal void along the aqueduct of Sylvius, and this with a hyperdynamic circulation and this with a communicating hydrocarbons. Okay, we can also notice that there is some sort of increased periventricular signal is better appreciated at the flare images. You can see here there is an increase in the periventricular white matter high signal in a periventricular white matter. This usually is due to likely to be transependymal CSF permeation. Okay, in these axial MRI and sagittal MRI images, we can find or we can notice that the patient had a moderate supra and infra tentorial ventricular dilatation out of proportion to the extra axial CSF spaces, and this with hydrocephalic changes, and there is no level of obstruction. So this means that the hydrocephalic changes is a communicating type, and we can see there is a CSF transependymal, minimal CSF transependymal CSF permeation. Also in the sagittal images here, we noticed that there is a small retrocerebellar cyst. This retrocerebellar cyst, as we said before, there is an algorithm for the retrocerebellar cyst. If we noticed a retrocerebellar cyst, we must first see if there is a hypoplasia of the cerebellum or the vermis. If the vermis missing some sort of some parts, this means that the retrocerebellar cyst with hypoplasia of the cerebellum is with a Dandy Walker malformation. So in this case, the retrocerebellar cyst here is not associated with a hypoplasia of the vermis. The vermis here is complete. There is no missing part in the vermis. In axial images, we can clearly see the pointed appearance of the inferior vermis. That means the vermis is complete and not missing. And there is the cerebellum here is more or less quite normal with no evidence of hypoplasia. So this cyst is not Dandy Walker malformation. The second step in the algorithm is to determine if there is a hydrocephalus or not. If the cyst is associated with a hydrocephalus, this cyst is plaque of pouch cyst. And as we mentioned before, in this case, there is a hydrocephalus. So this cyst is a plaque of pouch cyst. Okay. So in the ordinary MRI images, we illustrated that the patient had a communicating hydrocephalic changes and a plaque of pouch cyst. So what are the value of the MRCSF flowmetry in this case? The value of the MRI-CSF flowmetry in this case first is to confirm the diagnosis of the communicating hydrocephalus. And how can be done? This can be done by noticing the aqueduct of Sylvius. This is the MRI-CSF flowmetry. Okay, and we can clearly see there is the alternating dark and bright signal along the aqueduct of Sylvius, and this means that the aqueduct of Sylvius is patent with no evidence of obstruction. If we were worried about the dilatation of the fourth ventricle and the fourth ventricle is dilated or not, there is a minimal dilatation or not dilated, we can see the clear movement of the CSF along the aqueduct of Sylvius. This means that the aqueduct of Sylvius is patent, and this means that the aqueduct of Sylvius, there is no obstruction along the aqueduct of Sylvius, and again this means that the hydrocephalus here is not obstructive type, it is usually communicating type. This is the first sign our first value to confirm the diagnosis, the patency of aqueduct of Sylvius, and confirm the diagnosis of communicating hydrocephalus. The second value in CSF flowmetry to confirm the diagnosis of the a hydrocephalus is to measure the flow along the aqueduct of Sylvius. As we said, in a communicating hydrocephalus, there is a hyperdynamic circulation along the aqueduct of Sylvius. So the velocity of the CSF along the aqueduct of Sylvius is much higher. So we can notice, if we measure the velocity along the aqueduct of Sylvius, we can notice that the velocity parameters here is much higher. So we can depict that there is a hyperdynamic flow along the aqueduct of Sylvius, and again this with a communicating type of hydrocephalic changes. So this means this measurement is called a quantitative assessment of the aqueduct of Sylvius. We can depict we can do a qualitative assessment and we can do quantitative assessment. For assessment of the aqueduct of Sylvius, we clearly see the alternating bright and dark signal along the aqueduct of Sylvius, and this means that the aqueduct of Sylvius is patent, and this study is called qualitative assessment for the CSF flowmetry. By measuring the velocity along the aqueduct of Sylvius, and this means this is called a quantitative assessment. Measurement of the velocity along the aqueduct of Sylvius is called a quantitative assessment, and this with a in this study we can the CSF flowmetry add value in confirmation of the diagnosis of the CSF, the communicating type of the CSF flowmetry, either qualitative assessment through the patent, through the make sure the patency of the aqueduct of Sylvius, and through quantitative assessment through measurement of through measuring of the velocity along the aqueduct of Sylvius, and we clearly see that the velocity is a high reading of the velocity parameters along the aqueduct of Sylvius. Also, there is another value for the CSF flowmetry is to determine the retrocerebellar cyst, either communicating or not with the subarachnoid CSF spaces. If and this usually depends upon the qualitative assessment. If the cyst here, we can see this is the site of the retrocerebellar cyst. We can determine by the CSF flowmetry if the cyst is communicating with the subarachnoid spaces or not. And in this case, we can see there is no CSF flowmetry along the cyst. We can see this is the free movement of the CSF flowmetry here along with the subarachnoid spaces, but there is no free movement along the within the cyst. So this means that the retrocerebellar cyst or Blake of Pouch cyst is not communicating with the subarachnoid spaces, and this is important. And this with again with most of Blake of Pouch cyst does not communicate with the subarachnoid CSF study, and again this confirm the diagnosis of the Blake of Pouch cyst as we mentioned before. So the value of the CSF flowmetry in this study is to diagnose or to confirm the diagnosis of the communicating hydrocephalus first, and it is to the diagnose or to confirm the diagnosis of Blake of Pouch cyst, and this cyst either communicating or not communicating with the subarachnoid CSF spaces. The second case here is 14 years old boy who came complaining of recurrent otomastoiditis, underwent underwent mastoidectomy, and he came complain now from recurrent discharge. This is at the left side mastoidectomy bed here, we can clearly see there is a near complete opacification of the mastoidectomy operative bed here. This opacification is extending anteriorly here a little bit to the to the level of the to the level of the epitympanum, the upper part of the middle ear cleft, the epitympanum. So to less extent to the upper part, nearly it's completely obliterating the mastoidectomy operative bed. We can clearly there is a defective lateral part of the mastoid. This is typical with the mastoidectomy operative bed. The mastoidectomy operative bed usually have a defective lateral wall. This is the area where they enter, surgically enter, and the mastoid air cells. So it usually become defective. So this is the mastoidectomy operative bed. Clearly it is completely opacified by soft tissue opacification here. This soft tissue opacification extending to the epitympanum. So in this case we must determine if the opacification here is either residual or recurrent automastoiditis, or either it is a post-operative granulation tissue. Such opacification, so such large opacification here is usually with residual or recurrent automastoiditis inflammatory process, and this means that there is a residual or recurrent automastoiditis. Granulation tissue usually does not opacify the mastoidectomy operative bed at such extension. So we are in favor that this opacification is usually is with a residual or recurrent mastoidectomy operative bed inflammatory process automastoiditis. And in such cases we must determine multiple things. First thing is to determine if there is an erosion of the ossicular chain or not. Actually the ossicle here is more or less normal with our intact, with no evidence of ossicular chain erosion. The second and most important here is to determine the proper extension for such inflammatory process. You must look for the intracranial extension for such inflammatory process. And if you look only in bone window, you will miss the intracranial extension of such inflammatory process. You should look for the brain window or soft tissue window to determine there is a, as we see here, there is an elliptical shaped extraaxial epidural. Why you called epidural? This is a convex inner border. This is an epidural enhancing sheet along the posterior aspect of the left temporal region here. This is usually extension from the inflammatory process here along the posterior aspect of the temporal lobe. This elliptical or enhancing elliptical sheet here is convex inner border, is matching with the, this is a phlegmon formation with start of areas of non-enhancing within. This is a breaking down or liquefaction of the phlegmon, and start with start of abscess formation. So this is the important of to put your in your mind that the automastoiditis can extend intracranially, and you must look for the intracranial extension of the automastoiditis by looking for the soft tissue window, not spoon window. In spoon window, such extension is not, yes, it can, you can notice it here, but it is not clearly as in the soft tissue window. So you should look for the intracranial extension of the inflammatory process. And this clearly, this is an epidural enhancing sheet here. Usually this is an epidural phlegmon formation extension from the inflammatory process of the otomastoidytes. Okay, also in such area, if you find there is an intracranial extension in such area, you must look for the sinuses. And this is one of the serious and common complication. If there is an intracranial extension of the otomastoiditis, you should look for the sigmoid sinus and transverse sinus. This is the sigmoid sinus, and we can see this is there is a filling defect, hypodense filling defect within the sigmoid sinus, and this with matching the dural sinus thrombosis. We do a CT venography for this 3D venography for this reconstruction for this case, and we can clearly see there is an attenuation of the transverse sinus and near complete obliteration of the sigmoid sinus. This confirmed the diagnosis of the sinus thrombosis. So this case is a residual recurrent operative mastoidectomy, operative bed inflammatory process associated with an intracranial epidural phlegmon formations and sigmoid sinus thrombosis. Okay, the third case here is a 54 years old male who came complaining of symptoms and signs of chronic lower limb ischemia. And this is a typical case for what's called a Lurish syndrome. There is a complete or total obliteration of the infrarenal abdominal aorta and both external and common iliac, with collateral filling occur here along the common femoral artery. We can see here, this is the images is more clear. We can see there is a attenuation of the infrarenal abdominal aorta. Here there is a fusiform tapering of the infrarenal abdominal aorta, followed by total occlusion of the infrarenal abdominal aorta, just its aortic bifurcation, and the both common and extended iliac arteries are completely obliterated, and this is with a Lurish syndrome. But if you want to say this is a Lurish syndrome, you must you can't say this is a Lurish syndrome except if the occlusion is chronic. If the aorto-iliac occlusion is chronic, situation, you can say this is a Lurish syndrome. If the occlusion is acute, this is not a Lurish syndrome. And how can you diagnose the, or you can identify that the occlusion is chronic or acute? By the presence of the collaterals. If there is a much more collaterals present in the area, this is with an chronic occlusions, and this is a Lurish syndrome. If there is no collaterals, this occlusion is acute, and this is not a Lurish syndrome. And we can clearly see there is a multiple collaterals here in the lower abdominal and lower abdominal pelvic regions, and these collaterals are in favor with chronic occlusions, and this means that there is a this is a Lurish syndrome. This is chronic occlusion, and this is a Lurish syndrome. We can clearly see that the collateral filling here occur along the two, one of the important collateral here is along the external circumflex iliac artery to the common femoral artery, and another one is along this collateral here is the inferior pharynx. This is the inferior pharynx. This is the inferior epigastric. Sorry, I'm sorry. This is an inferior epigastric artery, who communicating with the superior epigastric artery. This is the inferior epigastric, and this is the circumflex iliac. And these are one of the important collateral branches who refill, usually refill the common femoral artery distally. This is the this again this is the inferior epigastric, and this is the external circumflex iliac, usually the deep circumflex iliac, and this is again this is the inferior epigastric, and this is the external circumflex iliac. So this is typical case of Lurich syndrome. Okay, 47 years old male who come accidentally discovered hepatic focal lesions. This is a triphasic study. This is the arterial, this is the portal, and this is the tiliate. There is a large hepatic focal lesion is seen exophytic from the left hepatic lobe, usually segment 2. This lesion in the arterial phase, it takes a peripheral nodular enhancement and with a progressive central fill-in at the delayed images. Such pattern is usually typical for hemangiomas because the peripheral enhancement here is matching the blood pool. This is the enhancement in the arterial phase, and this is the enhancement in the portal phase, matching the venous the contrast in the venous radicle. And in the delayed images also there is a complete there is a filling in of the lesions, and as we said that the contrast is matching the blood pool, so this is with a hemangioma. The other two possibilities for such a pattern of enhancement is cholangiocarcinoma and metastasis. Cholangiocarcinoma, there is no radicular dilatation, there is no capsular retractions. In metastasis, it is usually single one, there is no other lesions, so it is much less likely to be cholangiocarcinoma or metastasis. And again, if the pattern of enhancement matching blood pool is with the hemangioma. This is a typical case of a hemangioma, but there is an important sign here. In such large hemangioma, which called giant hemangioma, we always see there is a non-enhancing central area within the lesions. This is called central scar. In such giant hemangioma, large hemangioma, the complete fill-in never occur. The lesions never appear homogeneously opacified at delayed images, and always there is a non-enhancing central scar in such lesions, and usually this is again with a typical with a giant hemangioma. Okay. This is a 78 years old male who came complaining of liver cirrhosis and elevated alpha fetal protein tumor markers. We can see here there is a fairly defined lesions, partially exophytic from the right hepatic lobe segment 6. This is lesions showing a rather non-uniform enhancement at the arterial phase, and at the portal phase, this is there is some sort of washout in the portal phase, and the delayed phase, the enhancement or the washout become clearly and the lesions become hypo intense or hypodense rather as compared to the liver parenchyma. So this is a clearly washed out here. And if the lesions in a cirrhotic patient showing a enhancement at the arterial phase and washout at the delayed phase, this is atypical for the HCC. And this is matching with the elevated alpha fetoprotein and the cirrhotic patients. So this is atypical for a typical case for HCC. I present this case to add one value for the report here is to determine the arterial feeder for the lesion. You should mention the arterial feeder of the lesions. This is important to for the interventional procedure. The arterial feeders can be identified by the doing the MIB images. This is clearly the MIB images here, and this is the arterial feeder to the lesions. This usually comes from the right hepatic artery that comes from the celiac trunk. This is a normal branching of the right hepatic artery come from the arthrosis from the celiac trunk. In certain cases there is other variation in the blood supply for the or the arterial feeder for the lesion, and this is an important before, as we said, the interventional procedure such procedures. Okay, this is an important case here. This is a 56 years old male who came complaining of anemia. Okay, anemia in such elderly patient is an ominous sign, and you shouldn't take it lightly. And this is because that anemia in elderly patient is usually due to colorectal cancer. And so in such patient you should look carefully for the rectum and the colon, searching for the colorectal any masses, mural thickening is and for exclusion of the colorectal cancer. We can see here there is an irregular mural thickening here near to the hepatic flexure at the distal part of the ascending colon near the hepatic flexure. This is this mural thickening. As we see, there is a smudging of the surrounding fat planes and associated with enlarged pericolic lymph nodes. In coronal images here, we can see that the mural thickening here is taking about 4 cm short segment of the ascending colon, the distal part of the ascending colon, and we can clearly see there is a what's called everted edges. This everted edges is make the possibility of such irregular mural thickening is with a neoplastic process, and this is with a cancer colon. And again, this is matching the clinical sign of anemia. Anemia in such elderly patient, you must look for the colorectal cancer. It's very important. And there is, as we see, there is an irregular mural thickening. There is an everted edges, clearly everted edges, shouldering here. And there is a pericolic lymph nodes, usually a metastatic, regional metastatic lymphadenopathy with smudging of the surrounding fat plane. This is with a colorectal cancer. near hepatic fracture and with no evidence of proximal bowel obstruction. This is a typical case for the colorectal cancer, colon cancer, who present with an common and ominous sign of a anemia. Okay. Okay, this is a male patient who came complaining of dyspepsia. And abdominal pain. Okay, there is a rather circumferential long segment, bulky mucosal thickening involving the gastric fundus, here the gastric fundus, and the upper half of the gastric body. This circumferential bulky mucosal thickening, although this is a bulky involvement, we can see there is a bulky involvement, but there is a no luminal compromise. There is, although this bulky involvement, there is no luminal compromise. There is no definite luminal encroachment. We can see here. This is there is no luminal compromise. Even there is an aneurysmal dilatation, which is called aneurysmal dilatation of the lumen, is better appreciated here. This is a bulky involvement of the gastric mucosal thickening, and this is mounting to mass formation, but there is no lumen compromised, and the lumen here is completely patent and even is dilated. This is with a such characteristic mucosal thickening with the aneurysmal dilatation of the lumen. Again, this is with a gastric lymphoma with no sizable exophytic component, with clear surrounding facial plane. Again, with this the gastric lymphoma, and there is a bulky enlarged perigastric lymph nodes here with no evidence of areas of breaking down. Such lymph nodes is usually again with lymphoma. So this patient has a typical case of the gastric lymphoma with perigastric lymphadenopathy. Actually, it could be a spotting case by the presence of bulky extensions, bulky mucosal thickening, and long extensions, circumferential involvement, no evidence of luminal compromise associated with enlarged bulky lymph nodes, homogeneously enhancing bulky lymph nodes. This is all with a gastric lymphoma. Okay, the last case here is a 60 years old male who came complaining of hematuria. We can clearly see there is an irregular endophytic lesions that is affecting the left lateral wall of the urinary bladder. This is a regular endophytic lesions. It is an ulcerating, and this is clearly with a neoplastic lesion. If there is a focal irregular, such focal irregular mucosal thickening with ulceration, this is usually with a neoplastic process. We cannot determine if the lesion is a transitional cell or squamous cell, but by the instance, it is usually a transitional cell carcinoma. But we can see this is a neoplastic lesion, clearly see that it's a neoplastic lesions with a such focal extension and the irregularity of the mucosal thickening. Usually this is a neoplastic process. We can in MRI the value of the MRI, we can clearly see the proper local extension of such lesions. We can determine that there is a disruption, as we see the low signal of muscularis propria, and the extra vesical extension to the perivesical facial planes, and this is an important for staging, for local staging. If there is a disruption of the low signal wall or muscularis propria and extension to the perivesical space, this means that the stage of such lesion is 2T3 stages. Okay, and also there is a, we can see there is a multiple enlarged internal iliac lymph nodes. This is clearly with areas of breaking down within. This is early a metastatic from the such lesions. So this lesion or this patient have a transitional silica or neoplastic left lateral wall urinary bladder mural thickening associated with metastatic internal iliac lymph nodes and showing the stages TNM stages T3 N2 as this is a multiple lymph nodes N2 and there is no distant metastasis, so this is M0, so this is a patient with T3 N2 M0 urinary bladder neoplasm. Thank you.